Hello, everybody. For this first International Nash Day, we're going to discuss the prevalence of this disease. It is estimated that 12% of the adult within the American population is affected by Nash. 12% means 25 million people. So where does this figure come from? Who's concerned? And more importantly, what are the trends for the disease in the coming years? To answer these questions, we'll talk to Professor Rinella, a world-renowned hepatologist from Northwestern University in Chicago. We'll also ask Professor Lavine, a pediatrician from a renowned medical center in New York City, about the impact of Nash on children. We'll be going to Santiago, Chile, to meet a father and his daughter who both have Nash. And finally, we'll answer questions from web users. But first, let me introduce you to Professor Rinella. Hello, Professor.
Hello.
You're a world-renowned hepatologist, particularly in the field of liver disease and Nash. You publish more than 50 articles, and you co-wrote an article on the prevalence of Nash, which was published in June 2016. And there was one sentence you wrote that really grabbed my attention. As a conclusion, you said, quote, "As the global epidemic of obesity fuels metabolic conditions, the clinical and economic burden of NAFLD, that is fatty liver disease, that burden will become enormous." When you say enormous, does it mean that we should be alarmed?
Yes, I think we should be alarmed. I think that it is primarily driven by obesity, which is continuing to grow. And I think one of the most remarkable papers that has recently been published suggests that not only is the prevalence high, so the baseline prevalence of NAFLD in the United States and worldwide is approximately 25% of the world's population, 24.7 to be precise, based on a recent large meta-analysis, has fatty liver disease. And a percentage of those, approximately 20%, will have NASH, and then a smaller percentage of those will end up having liver disease. But what's very remarkable is that modeling predicts that about 2030, that percentage will grow to about 30% in the United States, but more concerningly, a higher percentage of those that have fatty liver will have NASH, and then a large percentage will develop cirrhosis, and that is going to have a huge impact on our population.
When we talk about NASH, it is often said that already today, 12% of the American adults are hit by NASH. Where do these figures come from?
Right. Well, I think it's very difficult to give a true prevalence of NASH because you have to do biopsies to diagnose NASH. And you can't really systematically biopsy sample the population in an unbiased way. So the highest prevalence of NASH has been reported to be about a little over 11%. But the true prevalence of NASH in the United States is probably closer to 5 to 6%. That number, though, will increase as the population continues to age, become more obese, and have a higher prevalence of diabetes.
On the screen behind us is a map of the world with the obesity figure per areas. Mm-hmm. 24.1% of the population is obese in the U.S., mm-hmm. 30%, over 30% in Latin America. Is NASH only linked to obesity?
It's not only linked to obesity, but I think that what that figure is also referring to is the fact that the prevalence of NAFLD tracks with energy excess or excess caloric intake. It's not only that. About 7% of people with fatty liver disease don't have obesity. You see a higher prevalence of people who have fatty liver disease or NASH specifically and don't have obesity in Asian countries, but by and large, it's the biggest impact you could have would be to reduce obesity on the disease.
So you would say that obese populations are those that are more susceptible to be hit by NASH?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes. So we went to Santiago, Chile, where father and daughter, Pedro and Constanza, both are hit by NASH. Let's see what doctors, you know, say about their disease.
Pedro was diagnosed with NASH 10 years ago. A few years later, his son was diagnosed with the same disease. And now his 20-year-old daughter, Constanza, has just been diagnosed with NASH.
Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo está Pedro? Asiento, por favor.
She's seeing her doctor for her first checkup since learning that she has the disease.
La razón por la que estamos con tu hija acá es por la importancia de señalar que cuando uno tiene un papá que tiene cirrosis por hígado graso no alcohólico, cirrosis por esteatohepatitis no alcohólica, y uno tiene hígado graso, el riesgo de desarrollar cirrosis en comparación a una persona que no tiene un papá con cirrosis se eleva como 12 veces.
Constanza is at an early stage, so she can still take action to slow down the disease.
En cuanto a la actividad física, ¿qué es lo que realmente hace en el hígado como que haga que mejore la situación?
Cuando una persona ha sido sedentaria toda su vida, no es que uno le pida que se convierta en un atleta. Hay que empezar.
Treating several members of the same family is becoming common practice for Dr. Arrese.
¿Por qué la población hispánica que vive en Sudamérica puede estar más predispuesta a tener esta enfermedad o a tener grados mayores de severidad de la enfermedad? Es una pregunta que no está del todo clarificada, sin embargo, algunos factores genéticos pueden influir, en particular algunos polimorfismos genéticos de genes que se han identificado afectan la gravedad de la enfermedad.
Siempre ha existido una preocupación, puesto que mi enfermedad es congénita, ¿no es cierto? Y uno se preocupa por los hijos.
Que de todas formas es un poco limitante el tener que restringirse tal vez en los tipos de alimentos, el hecho de tener como que cambiar el estilo de vida, de ser como totalmente sedentaria, tener un poco más de actividad física.
The most recent studies show that Latin America is even more affected by NASH than the United States.
Because it's mainly a lifestyle-related disease, one would think that, you know, it doesn't strike children. And yet, when we see that story, it does.
Yeah, it definitely does. You can actually, there are children who have cirrhosis from NASH.
Wow.
Strangely, but it is very prevalent. It's probably around 10% or so, but it's quite prevalent. And that's largely related, again, to obesity. There's some genetics associated with it as well, particularly in Hispanic communities and in South America as well, due to an increased prevalence of a gene called PNPLA3.
But that hits mostly more like, you know, Latin American people than
Correct.
Elsewhere in the world?
A little bit, though. The prevalence is higher in those
Why?
Groups. Yes. We don't really know why specifically, but we know that the prevalence or the relative import of that gene polymorphism is more important in those populations.
Okay.
And that may drive some of the disease.
Oh, I see. Yeah. So no one is basically spared, you know, from the disease. I mean, age group meaning, like, you know, it can hit any kind of age group today.
Correct. So I think the NASH is a very heterogeneous disease in general, but it has multiple factors that drive it. So obesity is a major driver. Children, the prevalence of obesity in children is high. This comes from dietary influences early in life in their family. Most people who have obese parents tend to have obese children. And with obesity comes the risk of diabetes. There are also microbiome, so bacteria that live in your gut, that can also be shared in families that can influence disease progression. So it can become quite complex.
So it's a multi-factor
yes.
Disease, I mean, triggering disease.
Yes.
Okay. Regarding the impact of NASH in children, we have interviewed Professor Lavine from New York. He noted the emergence of this disease in the 90s among young patients he was treating. Let's listen to what he has to say about it.
Professor Lavine is one of the first hepatologists who alerted about NASH disease among the young population. Since then, he keeps seeing the number of patients grow.
In terms of the United States, NASH is the most common chronic liver disease of children, and probably in many other areas of the world too. It's been reported in every continent. For the most part, nationwide, we usually find this problem in kids that are about 12 years old, just at the onset of puberty. They are generally obese with a body mass index of around 32, which is more than 2 standard deviations above the mean for where they should be. And then they have frequently high triglycerides, high total cholesterol, high low-density lipoproteins, or LDL. Low HDL, and oftentimes high indices of insulin resistance. So there are a lot of challenges associated with taking care of children that have NASH. Frequently, the families as a whole have a problem with their lifestyle, their sedentary behavior, the type of food choices they make, and the type of food that's served at different meals. So you want to talk to them as a family, adopting a change that will make it more likely that their child will be successful. by making a group activity as a family to go out and exercise before dinner and to shop together and shop responsibly. So this NAS education program is important for helping children better understanding what's happening to them, what they can do about it, why they should care to do something about it, and to make this a family venture that allows a family to walk and march together to make this problem mitigated and to recognize that the future is going to get brighter and brighter, not just in terms of lifestyle intervention, but in terms of therapies that are available to prevent this scourge.
How do you deal with such young patients? How do you cope with that?
I think you deal with the parents. In fact, part of what I do with every patient visit is I talked about the family eating habits, and I discuss the importance of preventing obesity in children and introducing good, not just food habits, but exercise habits in children. That will help prevent disease to a certain extent.
So education mainly.
Education is important.
So we have some prevalence figures among like populations at risk that are not age related. You know, up to 70% of type 2 diabetics and up to 90% of people who are obese. Can you remind us what type 2 diabetes is?
Yeah, so type 2 diabetes is basically when the body's ability to secrete insulin no longer is able to keep blood sugars under normal levels. The vast majority of people with fatty liver disease have what we would call pre-diabetes or insulin resistance, and this eventually develops into diabetes in many patients due to the body's inability to continue to produce insulin. You have failure of the beta cells in the pancreas to produce insulin over time.
Okay, so does that mean that if I fight against NASH, it implies fighting against type 2 diabetes and obesity?
So it's interesting that you would say that, and I think that at the beginning we thought that perhaps that was all you needed to do is to treat the insulin resistance, but in fact we've learned that it is insufficient to just do that. So you can treat diabetes effectively, yet you can still have NASH. So it's more complex than that. But it's important to treat both.
We just saw these dramatic figures, you know. What could be the short-term consequences of these figures?
Well, I mean, what you end up having, especially as the prevalence of diabetes continues to grow, that's why that modeling article published recently was so interesting, because it's that increasing prevalence of diabetes. It's going to enrich the population with NASH or, you know, fatty liver disease with liver consequence, inflammation, scarring. That's going to result in bad outcomes for our patients. So it's very alarming because
of
that.
Okay, so awareness is key, I guess.
Yes, awareness and prevention, yeah.
So Professor Rinella, for the last few minutes of the program, we'll be answering questions on the topic from web users. I've got one here that says, I'm type 2 diabetics and slightly overweight. Does it mean I have NASH?
Not necessarily, but what it does mean is that you are very likely to have NASH, because the majority of diabetics are going to have fatty liver disease, so up to 75% actually in some
75%.
Studies. So they're a much higher likelihood of having aggressive disease within the context of fatty liver disease.
So it's very likely.
Yes.
Another question is, my 14-year-old son was diagnosed with fatty liver disease 6 months ago. What are the risks for him to develop NASH?
Yeah, so if your 14-year-old has fatty liver, that is certainly concerning. There is definitely a genetic component, and probably up to 50% of the fatty liver is heritable, so that's concerning. The risk of developing NASH over a lifetime would largely depend on the development of other comorbid illness as he grows older, but certainly preventing obesity would be a very, very important thing, changing, you know, the diet to an increasing exercise activity.
Because otherwise, I mean, the risk of developing NASH will be greater.
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you, Professor Rinella, for answering all our questions. And thank you all for joining us for the International NASH Day. You can find all the information and the topic we've covered on our website. Thank you.